So I'm here with my famous chemist and Nobel Prize winner's tie. Brady gave it to me. And we're waiting for the 2015 Nobel Prize in Chemistry to be announced. And as usual, I have absolutely no idea who it's going to go to, which is what makes it really quite fun. But you remember, sometimes it goes to more to biology than to chemistry because there isn't a Nobel Prize for biology. We've already got some chemistry in the medicine prize, so chemistry has been recognized at least a bit already. So let's see what happens for the chemistry.
Are you going to give us a prediction?
I have absolutely no idea who it would be. Somebody suggested it might be for lithium-ion batteries. The battery on the mobile phone that you may be watching this on at the moment, but who knows? It's always the really
Fingerwatch Fusion Academy of
exciting moment
Sciences,
now.
välkomna till Kungliga Vetenskaps. Fusion Academy of Sciences has decided to award the 2015 Nobel Prize in Chemistry jointly to Thomas Lindahl, Paul Modrich, and Aziz Sanjar.
So I've rushed off and got a DNA model. I went into the coffee room and asked who'd got one. The only one I can find is this one, which is a bit dusty. And like the damaged DNA in the Nobel Prize, this one's also damaged. So I went back to the coffee room and got something a bit more reliable. These are the spares for the old coffee machine. Unfortunately, we don't use that coffee machine anymore, so I'm a bit restricted in what I've got for the model, but it's enough for you to understand. Just remember, your genetic information of all living things in the world are transmitted through DNA. DNA is a molecule that has two chains linked together. The linkages between the two chains are what carries the genetic information and can be translated into the making of proteins in your body. In the Nobel announcement, the lady who was explaining it said that each of our bodies has enough DNA, which, if it was stretched out, would go to the sun and back from the Earth 250 times. So there's an awful lot of it. Each time a cell divides, the DNA has to be replicated because one pair of chains has to be made into two pairs of chains, one for each of the new cells. When that happens, mistakes can be made, and the chemistry inside our cells can also damage the DNA. And this damage happens very quickly, 200 times a day, perhaps, for a given cell. So if there wasn't a mechanism to repair this damage, then we'd all die before we were even born. Now, Brady, who is very astute, says that really what this Nobel Prize is for is the DNA spell checker, that is, correcting mistakes, rather like a spell checker. But actually, it's better than a spell checker because I don't know about your spell checker, but mine sometimes puts in completely the wrong word because it misguesses what we've done. Now, let me try and explain to you. And before I explain, it's important to realize that there are lots of different ways that DNA can be damaged and repaired. But this is a really high-speed explanation, and we really need to do a proper video about DNA, and that will be coming quite soon, I hope. But for the moment, what happens with DNA is that you have two chains which are indicated by this white piece of plastic. And in between, you have so-called base pairs, which for this, I've just indicated the things that pair together are either lime green or dark green. It's slightly more complicated, but for this, that's enough. Now, the first sort of mistake is that one of the DNA chains, the one that's growing, could have the wrong pair. If we look at this, and this is just a tiny, tiny piece of the DNA chain, which would go on for miles in either direction. So here you have dark green, lime, lime, dark, lime, and then here there's a mismatch. Now, if you imagine that the one on this side is the chain that's growing, that's being synthesized, the way the spell checking works is that there is, it knows which one is the good copy, so it can spot the mistake. It should have been dark green and it's lime green. So what happens is that there are enzymes and a mechanism that chops out the bit that's bad and puts in the new one. You have to imagine that in the cell, there are lots of these free things swimming around, so you can always throw one away and add another one. It's just like, in theory, at least on your computer, there's an infinite supply of letters. So if you type an O instead of an A, you just throw away the O and type another A. So the first way is that you can just chop these things out. There is another sort of mistake where there's a chemical reaction that damages one of these bases and actually, for example, turns this into something else, which I've done red, which is, for those of you who are biochemists, is usually indicated with the letter U. So this one is one that shouldn't be in DNA at all. So there's another mechanism that was discovered by Thomas Lindahl where this is chopped out and the right one is put in instead. The final sort of mechanism is the one which it causes or is thought to cause some sorts of skin cancer from the UV light from the sun. And this is slightly different, where everything is okay in the completed DNA chain, and then the UV light comes, the UV light I'm showing with the stapler, and it just staples two of the bases together, so-called thymine. What it does is the UV light changes one of the thymine molecules so it reacts with its neighbour. This only happens where there are two of them next to each other, and of course that messes everything up. But there is a different mechanism which was discovered by the researchers in the United States, which chops out this pair that are joined together and replaces them with two more T's which are not joined together. Now, the importance of all of this is that it's what keeps us alive. It's understanding the fundamental mechanisms. There are other ways that DNA can be damaged. For example, if you smoke, some of the chemicals that come out in the cigarette smoke can interact with the DNA and damage the bases, and there are mechanisms that detect this and deal with it. Of course, smoking has not been around very long, so evolution has not got a special anti-smoking repair mechanism, but what it has done is to have a mechanism, a generalized mechanism, to detect things that are wrong and weed them out. Speaking of DNA damage, I took this out of my colleague's office while he was giving a lecture. Didn't even ask him. So don't tell him that I actually dropped a piece and trod on it. So we'll never repair the damage to this DNA. But all being well, the mutation won't cause any serious problem. And you can see, I can't read it from here, but it's about 173 grams.